Alright, so this time we're going to be dissecting pupae. So, in particular, we're looking at the pupal notum. So this is the area that's going to form the back of the thorax of the fly, where many of the bristles, the macroquets and microquets that are studied form. And that we're looking at a particular window of time of about 12 to 14 hours after the larvae go into their pupal stage, so it's called after puparium formation, so 12 to 14 hours APF. And so we have a bunch of pupae that were picked last night, I cleared the vials of any flies that had already formed pupae, and so there are only larvae around in the vials, and then kept them at 25 degrees for 2 hours. And then after that 2 hour period, then collected any that had become pupae and then put them in this dish to continue aging at 25 degrees overnight. And so that puts us in that 12 to 14 hour range, and basically slowed them down by putting them on ice, as well as some of our reagents for ice. So among the things that we've got in front of us, so we have our fixative, just like we've used for the larvae dissections. So this is PBS plus 0.1% Triton with 4% paraformaldehyde. And then, since in this particular, these pupae have GFP, that is expressing, we want to look at GFP once we fix. I like to keep them in the dark, and so this is basically a makeshift dark container for them to be incubating for the fixes and the washes. We're going to be using a cold 1x PBS while we are dissecting, and then we'll wash off the fix with 1x PBS plus Triton. We have one pair of forceps and then a pair of scissors. It's best to try and find for pupal dissections the smallest scissors that you can. And then we've got a pipette with, or a P200 pipette, with the pipette tip about three millimeters cut off the end of the tip, just to increase the diameter of the pipette. And we're going to use this for washing out the fat and some of the tissue that's in the thorax, so that we can just have the notum tissue and collect that with, get it as clean as we can. It's a little bit hard to get it super clean, but we'll try our best. And then the last other thing that we have here is a dish that has a gel on it for dissecting, as well as these tiny, tiny dissection pins. And so we're gonna use the pins to position the pupae in this dish. I usually like to arrange them in a ring around the center so that I can go around as I'm dissecting. And then we will put them in with the anterior side facing outward, because so essentially their heads facing outward, and we're going to pin them all down in this row in order to start dissecting. So that's the first thing that I'll do with this dish and our pupae. Let's go ahead and pull the pupae off of the dish. Sometimes the pupae get damaged in the incubation, so we may have some that are not good. We'll have to look at them and see how they survive being pulled out of their vials. If the incubator doesn't have a source of water or hydration, they can get dried out, and that can kill them. And so hopefully we have enough larvae that we can dissect. I can see now we've got several that are actually probably are not good for dissecting, because it looks like they didn't develop very far. And so we have a larger number of them that we trash. But we'll see. Let's take a look at it. In which case, then, maybe I'll do them again, but put them in a human chamber. But hopefully we should have enough, both for my purposes with these, but then also enough to show the dissection process. And so what I'll do is just line them up by hand using the microscope. And so you'll just see me lining them up there on the camera. And then once we actually start the dissection process, then we'll switch to looking through the oculars. Yeah, we've got a fair number of larvae that didn't look like they made it for whatever reason. So I'll separate those out and then we'll look at those that failed versus those that look like they're good. So we've got several good ones, but also several bad ones. So I'll go ahead and line up the good ones. I actually have a bunch of water droplets, condensation at the bottom of this container because I had it sitting on ice. So that's actually useful for holding them in place. Sometimes water droplets at the bottom of the dish can be your enemy. So we've got five good ones, five not so good, or sorry, several more that are not so good. But let's go ahead and have a look at them and show you what they look like before we actually start lining them up. So these are the larvae that are pretty well developed as pupae. And so what you can see is that even at this stage, we can start to see them forming little flies inside their pupa cases. So we can make out the head region up here. And then this is the region of the thorax that we're gonna go after. And then there's the abdomen. And so then you can even see actually in this guy, see kind of the formation of the legs by this stage in development. So that what we're going to do is we're going to use these pins over here and then pin down each of the pupae in this particular orientation. So we have them with the ventral side up and the dorsal side down. So we can, on the ventral side, we have the remnants of the larval mouth hooks are visible here. And then we can also see the anterior spiracles that the larvae evert out just as they go from the white from the larvae to the white prepupa stage. And then now here we can see the larvae that are not quite so good. So they've got a big air bubble right smack in the center. And it looks like basically once they became pupa that they went downhill pretty quickly. And so this could also be sometimes what some of the early larvae look like while they're going through the process of dissolving a lot of the larval tissue. But by this stage, what they should have looked like, since they were all picked within a 2-hour window, we should get more of them that all look like this. So don't know what happened this particular time, But that all of these, they're not worth dissecting because they're not at the right stage. So we'll go ahead and get rid of these and then pin down the other ones, and then show you what they look like after they're pinned down. Just get rid of all of these screwed up pupae. Just be disposed of. Alright, and then we'll just go ahead and use the forceps to pull out some of the pins one by one and then stick them about in the center of the abdomen area, kind of right through where the legs are. And basically, I do two pins per pupa. Because as you'll see once we start doing the dissection process, that they will try and spin around that pin. And so we use the second pin to stabilize them so they don't spin around. Alright, so with fewer pupae, that means less time I need to spin around, so we'll go ahead and show you what they look like after we've spun them around. So here they are after they've been pinned. You can see the two pins that are there in the abdomen. There is a little bit of airspace at the back of tip of the abdomen. So we want to make sure that you actually get both pins in the abdomen proper itself. And then essentially what we're going to do is then go after the notum tissue. And the main process by which we do this is that first, I'm going to make a cut to remove the very tip of the pupil case at the anterior. And there's a nice gap in between where the pupil case extends. So this is the cuticle from the larvae to then where the pupae actually is, the developing fly inside the pupil case. So we'll make a cut along here to remove this. And then that allows us a window to get the very tips of our fine scissors, and we'll make a cut essentially down the end to the pins there, and then that will essentially make a cut along the pupil case. And then with that cut, and then just the natural lines and weak points due to the cuticle formation, what we'll be able to do then is grab the forceps and then along the cut, then pull the pupa case, rotate it off around the larvae, and then pull it off. We'll see how successful I'm actually doing it using while going through the camera instead of going through the the microscope oculars itself. But so I may screw these guys up, but we'll see how it works. So then once we've removed the pupil case, then, and I usually like to do this in a dry environment. And then once we have the pupil case removed, then we'll add cold PBS and then do the remainder of the dissection in cold PBS, where then we'll make a cut through the head of the pupae so that then we can essentially do a similar cut. And to do relatively clean notum, what I will like to do is make two cuts through the pupae, so on either side of the lateral edges of the pupae, and then make a cut right by the pins, and so then that will remove the ventral half of the pupa, and then expose the inside of the pupa, where we'll be able to see a whole bunch of fat and stuff that we'll want to just blow away with the pipette, and then there'll be trachea underneath it, and the trachea can trap some of the fat and other tissue on top of the notum, and so then I like to use forceps and pull off of the trachea, and then essentially just try and blow as much of the fat away. The pins and the abdomen trap a lot of fat, so sometimes you'll get some fat kind of coming in onto the notum itself as you try and remove the notum once we're done. So we want to try and get rid of as much of the fat as possible. But so, all right, let's go ahead and give this a shot. So just go ahead and take my scissors. Clean it with my hand sometimes. This is requires a bit more precision than doing a larval dissection, so don't be surprised if I screw up these pupae here. But do my best. Okay, so it looks like I depressed on the anterior edge of the pupa and it caused it to squeeze a little bit too much, and so we extruded some of the stuff inside the pupa out the back of the abdomen. And some of that happens. All right, okay. So we've got the anterior tips removed, and so now I'm going to try and reposition them so I can slide in the scissors and try and carefully get in between the top and the bottom. And this is where I'm trying to go through the camera may lead to some hilarity. I'm trying to do many small cuts. Getting too deep and pushing the larvae or pushing the pupa back inside. So that's kind of what I want to do. You can see I'm pushing on the pupa a little bit and pushing it back. It's like learning how to dissect all over again. Okay, not too bad. Cue the circus music. Would this go a lot faster if I was not trying to do it through the camera? Probably. But at least I'm doing 5 and not 30. Okay, there's 2. Okay, so we've made those cuts down the pupae, and so now I'm going to go ahead and then remove the pupa case covering the pupa. And so I'm going to basically try and grab right where I cut. It's also tricky. So it cuts, there we go. And so right by the pins I can grab and then kind of pull it across like that. And then on the other side, can pull. And all right, so you got one pupa case removed. Let's try and straighten this guy out. Got all of them. Okay, so now try and separate them a little bit from each other. We'll do that also after we add PBS. So then now just add cold PBS and then cover the larvae with PBS. Do that with a Pasteur pipette. And we'll try and separate them out again. And you can see there's a bubble underneath this one. So bubbles are not your friends for pupil dissection. So you can use the forceps to remove that bubble, or try and blow it away using the micropipette. And then also with adding PBS, probably have to adjust the focus a little bit. Okay, and then I'm going to take the pipette and just try and blow away the bubbles and make them pretty clean. Okay. Alright, so then now the next step is to go ahead and make a cut just like we had kind of done before, and then make a cut through the head, essentially cutting off the antennae. And then giving us a place to then make further cuts. So you can actually, this is a good pupae to see that we can look at the different demarcations. And even just zoom in a bit on this guy. Yeah, so you can see here we've got the head of the pupa, and then here is the notum. We can see that we've got some of the legs are coming down crisscross over the top. We can even see on this side, you can see some of the bit of the wing that is developing, sticking out. So that's where we are at here. And I'll zoom back out in order to make these cuts. But we will want to go and zoom in a little bit more for doing the final steps. Okay, and so then I'm going to go down on either side and then make cuts to remove the ventral portion of the head and thorax. Same for all the other ones. So then now we'll then make a cut by the pins and then release that ventral portion from on top. Let's see how well it behaves. So you can now see that the more I cut into them, the more there is like fat and other stuff getting all over the place. Now just go ahead and take the forceps and then just make sure we remove that portion. Looks like I did not cut that one clean away. And so now we're on the risk of removing the whole rest of the pupa. So let's see if I can salvage this. Okay, all right, let's go ahead and pick that up. Okay, so then now if we zoom in, you can see it's really hard to distinguish everything, but what we can notice is there is this little bit of gut here that can be pulled out in a way. Pull it straight out. Try and do that for each of them. So can't, not so visible on that one. May have come with the top part. And then pull it out for this one. And then for this one. May have come out. Can see a little bit of the trachea kind of underneath there. So we are going to try and pull those out. It's not actually, why don't we just go ahead and do that? As long as we can see them, let's try and remove those trachea. Got to be careful because they will also pull on the pupa. Not quite as easy to find, but you can see here I have pulled the trachea and pulling it out. You know, I've gotten both of them. May have got a little bit of trachea out with that. You can see it kind of here just down below. You can always go back after we've tried and blown away some of the fat that's in there to try and pull them out. And this one, since it got rotated, might have a little more difficulty getting to that. So why don't we come back to that one? Okay, so now the next step is to try and blow away some of that fat. So that's where our pipette comes in. And so just like to suck up some of the liquid, place it pretty close to the pupae, and then just kind of suck up and then blow away some material. So you can see a lot of fats going away. And then, since we only have five, the solution's not too bad, but what I often like to do is remove a lot of this this PBS now that has a whole lot of fat floating around in it, and then that'll help it be a little bit clearer to see the pupae as we're going about. So let me just go ahead and replace the PBS with some clean PBS. Dump it into the waste container. And then take some fresh PBS. Still have some people. There they are. Okay, so on some of them we can see that we've got, actually these are some of the lobes of the brain that are still attached. We did remove a bunch of the brain as we were both cutting them. Actually, so here's another one. We can see there is a developing fly brain right here, but we're not interested in a fly brain. So all of you neuroscientists out there, that sorry, we are removing the brain because we're not interested in it. And then we can examine each of the carcasses to just kind of see if we got additional trachea to remove. So we got some stuff that we can pull out and get out of the way on this one. And then you can better see, looks like we didn't do a good job of removing the trachea, but now we've got, it's pretty visible here on the right. And so we can try and pull that out. All right. And let's have a look at this one here. That one looks pretty clean. That one looks pretty clean. This one has some additional material on top that we can pull out. I do see there's a little bit of trachea. I didn't think that we had gotten it completely out of here. So let's try and pull this off. Okay. And then for this one up here, slide it down a little bit. This one has some stuff in it, but actually washing it looks like we righted it. So now I can actually try and pull some guts and trachea out, and then maybe even try and wash that guy a little bit too. Trachea removed. Okay, so now these guys are pretty clean and pretty clean enough for us to be able to go ahead and cup them. So what I usually like to do is then just go ahead and take and separate the thorax from the abdomen by cutting along again. So for this guy, here was the head, here's the thorax, and so then we'll try and cut behind the thorax. From the scissors. Next one, you can see there we got a little bit of fat coming in from the abdomen. Alright, and so then what we'll do is then just very carefully, what I like to do is grab each notum with forceps and then just drop it into the fix. And for that, I actually will be a little more careful and then look through the oculars rather than through the camera in order to look at those. Trying to very carefully not even close down and actually grab the notum, but just kind of collect it in the space in between the forceps. And that's number two. So now we've got our notum, drop them in our little dark container, and then we will let them fix for 3 minutes. And then afterwards we'll wash in PBT for 10 minutes each, do 5 washes for 10 minutes each, and then you can either add a block or antibody, depending upon how you like to do the procedures. So typically I do a lot of antibody stains in the notum without blocking, and that usually does pretty well. Don't have too much background, but it does depend upon the antibody. All right, and then the rest of it basically just involves cleaning up this this little dish here, and then that's it.